All right, let's get to the main event here. I'm super excited to welcome Lisa K. Solomon. She's a design innovation expert. She's a managing director of transformational practices at Singularity University. She's a co-author of this awesome new book that came out, Design a Better Business. But that's actually not her first book. I've only written one book. I'm like, that's enough work for me. She's done, this is her second, at least, that I know of. The other one is Moments of Impact, How to Design Strategic Conversations that Accelerate Change. That's her Twitter handle, and we're going to be giving away copies of her book. And I'm really excited to hear what she has to say about how to apply design thinking within your team and also throughout the rest of your organization. So let's give her a big welcome for Lisa. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you so much. It is really fun to be here the day after my book came out. So that essentially means this talk is a prototype, and I feel like I'm in fantastic company for you to be prototyping. So I actually will be sharing some new material from the book, but I will say that this is work that I've been passionate about for over 15 years, really thinking about the choices we make through the lens of a designer, thinking about design as a leadership practice and skill that we can all learn is something I'm deeply passionate about. So Dan asked how many people here were designers. Let's see those show of hands. There's about a third of you. Okay, but how many people think of themselves as a designer? May not have designed, look at that, right up, like, yes, I'm, okay, so we got maybe a few more, and I'm hoping that by the end of this hour, I'll get most of you going to at least your chin. You don't have to go all up like our friend Jim did over there, but at least if I can get you thinking differently about your role as a designer as it relates to creating value for the organizations that you work in, for the customers that you serve, for the product, the partners that you connect with. I think of design in a much more holistic way than we tend to think of design. And so I've been spending a lot of time telling people, no, design is not something you see in a beautiful shelf in a museum. Design is a way of practicing value creation, and it's something that we all can do every day. So as Dan said, I think of myself as a design educator, fundamentally empowering individuals to embrace the practices and disciplines of design so that they can create value for others around them, not just in their organizations, but also in their personal lives. And I'm glad we're going to have a little time after over beers to talk about that. I think that innovation really comes from innovators. And for the last 6 years, I've been teaching innovation as a teachable leadership skill at the MBA in Design Strategy up in the city. So imagine an MBA program housed in a 108-year-old art and design school in the heart of San Francisco. Their belief is that leaders of tomorrow shouldn't have to sacrifice their creative problem-solving skills in order to get the critical thinking credentials that we typically think of in an MBA. So we get the creative problem-solving approach merged with the critical thinking so that we can better be better prepared to handle the complexity that the world tees up for us. I've also taught at the D School. I've worked very closely with the Kauffman Fellows for Venture Capitalists. And as Dan said, in the last 2 months, I'm so delighted that I joined Singularity University as principal faculty and managing director of a new practice there around transformational practices. Singularity, for those that you don't know, is housed in NASA's Research Park in Moffett Field. This is a picture of Hangar 1. It's still cool to look at. You just come down and see it. It's just cool. And Singularity was founded back in 2008 by Peter Diamandis, Ray Kurzweil. Many of you might have heard of The Singularity is Near. Any fans of The Singularity is Near? Essentially predicting the future of technology that at one point we're going to merge with humans. And Ray and Peter really had this idea to create a single place where leaders could come to learn about exponential technologies to empower them to create impact on some of our world's most challenging issues. So not one technology, but many technologies, technologies like robots and AI and autonomous cars. And so I'm going to be joining there to help bring the technologies into these disciplines so that when leaders come and join us, they really know how to ignite change when they go back home. So fundamentally, my whole career has been spent around helping leaders deal with worlds that look like this. So these are just a picture of some recent cover stories that suggest that the kinds of problems that we're facing are increasingly nasty. They're complex. They're filled with multiple rooted issues. And so what it means is that if we care about coming up with solutions, we can't go at it in the same way that we think of solving typical problems. So there's a world, there's a name for this, this world filled with increasing volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And the military coined it a couple decades ago, and they said this is the VUCA world. And we don't need to look much further than just turning on the TV, turning on the radio, looking at our Twitter feed to see that we are filled with many VUCA problems. And if we care about making a difference in the world, we have to get more comfortable with this complexity, and we have to learn new skills on how to do good in the world, how to ignite impact and scale it. And that was the premise of my first book called Moments of Impact that Dan mentioned. And it was this notion that strategy needs to come from a different approach, that we can't look at strategy just in the old way of coming up with big strategic plans that then sit on the shelf and then we actually do our real work. That strategy, in fact, had to adapt itself, that we need to think of strategy less like a mechanical process and much more like a design process. And so this was my first foray in describing the tradecraft of design other than creating a thing or creating a service, but designing strategy through dynamic conversations that we could intentionally create to be both collaborative and creative. So I think of design fundamentally as one of the most important leadership skills you can learn, and that's in fact the first chapter of the book, the most important leadership skill you've not been taught anywhere. So I think of designers of better futures are the leaders that are making choices to create value in this world in a very different way. And these are just some of the designers that I look up to and try and learn from. So on the top row, you see people in our general media, folks like Jon Stewart, who used to design The Daily Show to be this magnificent 22-minute summary of the news events told in a way that we were laughing and crying and learning something all in the same moment. Trevor Noah's doing a good job getting there, but he's not Jon Stewart. Jerry Seinfeld, the way he thinks of his jokes. People think, oh, he's a stand-up comedian, just gets up there and tells a joke. Jerry Seinfeld can spend years perfecting a joke. And he does it through the iterative process, probably much like you design products. He tries it out. He's in stand-up. He looks for laughs. He looks for responses. He changes his tone. He changes a word. That's how he designs comedy. Lin-Manuel Miranda, any Hamilton fans? Yeah, oh my gosh, right? He is one of the ultimate designers of culture. The way he's designed the story of Hamilton, a story over 200 years old, to be as present today and impacting our future, an incredible set of choices he's making that went into designing Hamilton. In the middle, we see some folks here from Silicon Valley and the Bay Area. We have Hillary Hartley all the way on the left. She is the executive director of 18F, a design agency within the federal government. They're doing the heroic task of trying to redesign things like the VA and our tax system. We have Stuart Butterfield there. I saw Slack, right? So an incredible designer. I love Slack's, like, was it Life Less Busy? Yes, right? Trying to design a little bit more joy into our days. And the folks at the bottom are students of mine that I've had the pleasure of teaching at the MBA in Design Strategy that are now doing courageous things like Sue Pollock on the right, who's working for the Nature Conservancy, trying to design how we protect our most precious lands. Or Adam Dole, who's working hard to design healthcare. So we can think of design in a much broader way around how we are willing to tackle some of our most difficult issues. So before I go on and on about design, I thought maybe we should pause and say, what do we mean when we say design? Because I think design is quickly becoming one of those words like innovation. If I asked all of you what you thought design was, I might get a different answer from all of you. So I'm just going to put out my definition of design for the simplicity of tonight and encourage us to continue to talk about it. So this definition comes from Nathan Shedroff, who is a colleague and friend who started the MBA in Design Strategy program and is really one of the original thinkers of experience design. He actually wrote the book Experience Design, and he was codifying it as a strategy for companies over 15 years ago. And what Nathan says is that as a designer, it's not my job to make things look beautiful per se, or to choose red or blue or white. He says, it is my job as a designer to make choices that trigger the right responses. So the intentionality of making a choice in order to get a response from someone, that's what you hoped it would be. And if you think about that through the lens of how we think about where value comes from, we think about it in terms of a job that we're doing on their behalf. So that means we need to know what job they care about, and we need to know how we're going to make choices that help them get that job done. And we can take a look at some products, as an example, that we call well-designed or great design, because they do that job beautifully. So we have Apple that really put design on the map as a strategic capability. We have the Dyson vacuum cleaner, another iconic well-designed. Any Dyson vacuum cleaner owners? Yeah? How do you feel about your vacuum cleaner?
I love it,
right? Oh, we love it. We have three of them. Do you have the cordless? The wireless? Yes, 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 and yes, right? It's a vacuum cleaner, and he loves it, right? or the Herman Miller chair, right? Which just fits us so well in our lumbar, and we're breathing, and we want to sit for hours, even though sitting is the new smoking, we're still sitting because Herman Miller designed it to be that way, right? And we could say, well, you know, Apple, I don't know so much anymore, but, you know, this is a picture we're still sleeping out for our Apple phones. This just happened last week. And I heard someone traveled, you know, 100,000 miles to sleep outside to get the new iPhone 7. So we can really break down great design as understanding what is the functional utility I need to create with this product or service or meeting or conversation or team dynamic, and equally important, what are the choices I can make to make them feel something? What is the emotional engagement that we're going after? And as I thought about preparing for tonight's talk, I really thought about this emotional engagement piece, because you all are ninjas. You've been thinking about lean startup stuff for a long time. You know a lot about Agile. You're very clear about the process of getting new products off the ground from the standpoint of measurement. So throughout the talk, I'm really going to emphasize that our role as designers is not to forget about this emotional engagement part. Because if we do, something like this happens. Anybody have this experience? Right? So this is I love this picture. I never get tired of seeing this picture because the product underneath that packaging is probably beautifully designed. I'm sure research people and designers, industrial design maybe, he's not so sure on that light bulb. But it's a beautiful product in terms of doing the job we needed to do. It lights our rooms. It's now a little bit more environmentally friendly. But the design memo forgot to get to the packaging people, right? They had a totally different memo. They had a memo that said, use this material and make sure you can stick it on a shelf and make sure people don't stick that tiny light bulb in their pocketbook, right? So let's create it big. If you ever go to Costco and you see this little product and these big things, it's because they think that you're a thief and they don't want you to stick it in your pocketbook. That's not really the delight memo that I was hoping for. So this is so prevalent, there's a name for it. Someone actually named it on Wikipedia. Anyone want to know? It's called rap rage. And what's so funny about this is that rap rage spikes on what certain day of year? Anyone? Christmas. So think about this through the lens of a designer, right? We're all designers. So we're triggering the right responses for our children who've been looking at these presents underneath the tree for months and months, anticipation's building, Santa's coming. And what do the parents feel, right? It was not designed for the parents to feel delightful. And this is the moment where we all feel rap rage, probably about 9:30 in the morning trying to open up the toys, right? Yes, rap rage.
Dave Barry talks about the Institute of Defensive Packaging in one of his columns. It's worth looking at.
Okay, I'll check it out.
This is also why Amazon makes money by charging you for frustration-free packaging.
All right. See, opportunity, thinking like a designer. This is a real opportunity here, right? And they saw that. So what do we do when we can't get access to the things we want, these packaging? We hack our way there, right? And then we end up in clinics and hospitals, and it's a bloody mess. Of course, we can take a page from Apple again, who said, you know, packaging doesn't have to be the afterthought. Packaging can be as beautiful and beautifully designed to trigger the right response as the product itself. And in fact, we have great examples of beautiful packaging. Okay, truth time. Anybody here save their Apple packaging? I know you have. Look at that. So, right? Is that because you're hoarders? No. It's because Apple designed it that way. A little bit of a hoarder. Okay, Apple designed it that way. We have like stacks, right? The phones don't even work anymore, but we have the packaging, right? So all this is to say, if we think of ourselves as designers that are making intentional choices to trigger the right responses, I would also say that is the role of a leader. So if we consider ourselves leaders and we make choices that affect other people, then we are also designers. Whether or not we're intentional about it, whether or not we're actually putting the craft behind it, that is the notion of designing and leadership. So we have to ask ourselves, what are the responses we want to trigger? What are the responses we want to trigger with our products and how they serve our customers? With our teams and how we work together, with our organizations, how this capability sits within the larger organization and how we're perceived, and with ourselves, how do we trigger the right responses? So this notion of leader as designer. And that's what led to the second book, Design a Better Business, because what we saw, my co-authors and I, Patrick Vanderpyle and Justin Loketz, what we saw was that there was a lot of great conversation happening around design thinking. So thanks to our neighbors down the road with Stanford D School and IDEO, there's been a wonderful surge of design thinking. SAP is another great leader of design thinking. And we've gotten good at codifying this practice of design thinking. At the same time, there's this wonderful lean startup movement happening where we're learning that we have to gather data to see if our products are actually delivering the value that we think they are. And we're embracing a customer discovery. And we're also learning that business models matter, that there's a process around business model innovation. And this is work that started with Alex Osterwalder and business model generation about 6 years ago. So all these things are coming together, and we're going, that's fantastic, and what do I do on Monday? So we wanted to take that together and really create a streamlined book that really acted like a visual field guide for you to really learn how to ignite value and scale it within your organization. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to talk about three of the core principles in the book I'm very passionate about. I'm going to ask that you guys along the way maybe have a quick conversation with your neighbor because it's late and we should make this valuable for all of us. And let's face it, I love conversations. I like to design them. So if you're with me on this, we'll try to learn from each other along the way. So the first topic I want to mention that is absolutely critical if we are thinking of ourselves as a designer is this notion of fostering discovery, making choices that foster discovery. And I just want to suggest, and this was true in the first book and the research that we did as well, and more I see it, the more connected we are, I would say, the more wired we are for near-term responses. And this is the ultimate enemy of discovery, of being in a discovery mode. Is that we are bombarded with all these things that call our attention, right? So we get into a situation like this, right? We need to stay focused on our marketing priorities. And what? Squirrel, right? Squirrel. What's the shiny new initiative that's come your way that's taken you off track of your discovery mode? And I would say one of the biggest culprits that's taking us out of our curious discovery mode, which is so critical to thinking like a designer, because if you don't know who you're designing for and you don't know what they need, then you don't know what you're building, right? You've got to stay in discovery mode to really understand what it is that they need from you. And one of the biggest culprits of this, I would argue, is something we're all experiencing right now, and it looks something like this. Does this look familiar to anybody? This was my last week, for reals. This is really what it looked like. So where was I doing that discovery? Where was I doing that creative thinking? Probably in my 20-minute run before my 9 a.m. on the 14th, right? And literally, I covet those moments where I have the white space, right? And this is so prevalent in our everyday. Is there anything good on there? I'm calling it rapper rage. Calendar rage. It's just as bad, right? We're so frustrated. We want to do good strategic thinking. We want to do hard work. But, like, our calendar's killing us. So I would argue that one of the first things you can do if you care about design in your organization is cancel half your meetings. And I'm not kidding. Ask yourself, like, is there utility from this meeting? Is there going to be useful emotion from this meeting? And if not, then the person that called it has failed you as a designer, and I give you full rights to email back and say, how is this time going to be worth mine giving it to you? Because you can't get that back. And the evidence is clear on this. There's lots of different research you can bring up to say that we are getting killed with stress and busyness. And, you know, one of the ones came out of the Energy Project that said, look, we just do not have enough time for creative and strategic thinking. And yet the World Economic Forum ranked creative thinking as one of the top 10 skills that all organizations are going to need, right? So we just don't have this time to do this discovery work. So we have to go from near-term thinking and all of these really poorly designed mechanisms that are keeping us from the important work of discovery to fostering a discovery orientation. And what that looks like in our work when we think about design is moving away from this hero notion of my idea will save the day. You know these people, right? I had the idea. It's going to save the day. And we're going to have it, and it's going to scale immediately. And this chart, if it were accurate, would go up and to the right. Right? That's the way we think about great ideas here. Even though we're trying hard with all these wonderful methodologies to change that mindset, we still have it, right? I have an idea, it's going to be brilliant. And I would argue we need to move away from that superhero, solo, great idea to scalable genius and profitable growth to much more of a hero model that's based on honoring curiosity. And my favorite hero is Nancy Drew. So I know this dates me terribly, but Nancy Drew was a teenage girl with no superpowers. She didn't come from Krypton. She couldn't see through walls, right? But she had tenacious curiosity and bravery. And she was courageous enough to take her hypothesis about the mystery she was trying to solve, to gather evidence, to try and see if that hypothesis was right. And she was willing to change if the evidence suggested that it was not what she thought it was, right? Sound familiar? So what did she have? She had the ability to ask questions, to be open-minded, to gather information, and to iterate, right? This is something that we are used to now in the design and the lean startup process. So this is this notion of discovery as a process. And I think the Lean Startup Movement and Steve Blank and Eric Ries really helped us develop an important vocabulary around this process, this notion around building, measuring, and learning as an iterative mechanism for understanding discovery if the idea that we had is actually useful to the people that we need it to be useful. So there's just one issue with that, which is, was it the right idea in the first place? Like, once we start iterating on this great idea, are we willing to go back and say, wait, where did that idea even come from? And is it the right idea? So what we did in the book, Design a Better Business, is that we took the process, some of the core elements of design thinking, and we added a little bit of extra ideas to make sure that you always were able to go back to ask yourself, is this idea really the idea that's going to be most useful to our customers and to our business? So we created this double loop process. So this notion of an idea helps inform a point of view, which is at the center. And wait for it, I've got one more before you take a picture. I got a punchline. And that point of view, you need to then go after as your first mode of discovery to understand your customers, understand your business, go out into the wild to see if it actually is creating value. From there, you can ideate and innovate new ideas and then prototype and validate. Oh, okay, wait for it, scale. So that then we get ready to scale. And so what this allows you to do is to come back to check that point of view. And one of the core aspects of a designer is to be willing to have a point of view before you have all the data to figure it out. Can you hold it and still go after that data and then be willing to change it? We used to talk about this notion of strong ideas loosely held. Most entrepreneurs I know have strong ideas strongly held. Right? Oh, you just don't get it. You just don't get it. It's really good, right? It's a really good product. You just don't get it. You're just not my target market. Like, really? Okay. So can you have strong ideas loosely held based on the evidence that you're gathering? So really, we're looking at discovery as a process and discovery as a set of skills. And so some of the skills that we talk about in the book, so we have a process, and then we back that process by a number of skills and a number of tools to help you start using this right away to be as useful as possible. So one of the core tools we talk about for discovery is this notion of observation. How good are we observing? Do we go around the world around us? Do we know our customers? Are we willing to be an ethnographer? Are we willing to be a fly on the wall? Are we willing to actually watch and not try and pitch? That's one of the hardest things to do. Can you just watch and not pitch? Can you see where their hacks are? Can you see what brings them joy? And if you couple observing with the other skill that's absolutely critical for discovery, which is questioning, are you curious? Are you willing to ask your customers why they're doing what they're doing? Or ask yourself, I wonder why they're doing what they're doing. Not judging, not they're doing it wrong. Not, oh, if they only had my idea, this wouldn't happen. But can you allow yourself to sit in that discovery mode, observing and questioning again and again and again? And I know that there are a lot of design thinking fans in the room, and I thought it might be interesting for you to know that the origins of design thinking actually came from a class at Stanford and then ultimately a book called Visual Thinking by Robert McKim. And this was one of the first articulations of a non-linear problem-solving process that was focused primarily on what you see. Are you observing? So this book is really fun to look at. Look at, it's like from the 70s, you can tell, and you can get it. It's out of print, but you can get copies. But it really helps you understand some of this foundational principles and practices behind design thinking. And I think it's very interesting that it was called Experiences in Visual Thinking. So Bob McKim was a professor in the product design department. David Kelly was his student, then became his TA. Then he also started teaching there, and, you know, and. So here we are. I want to share, I thought it was fun to think about, like, where did I first learn about discovery? And it turned out it was over 20 years ago. This was my first discovery mission. We call them, you know, customer journeys, where we watched. And my very first consulting project was in 1994 with Dunkin' Donuts. Now, Dunkin' Donuts at the time was worried that they had the most fattening product on the planet. Do you all know that donuts are actually fried? Most people don't know that. They are fried. Okay, and at this moment, Jane Fonda was like the height of her career. Like, she was aerobicsing out, Jane Fonda. We learned that fat was bad for us. You know, there was like lots of new news coming out about nutrition, and like things were not looking good for Dunkin' Donuts. And so they brought us on, and we were an innovation firm, but we didn't call ourselves that because nobody called themselves an innovation firm. So it's tiny little firm in Connecticut. We were a marketing firm. We were brought in to help with marketing problems. And they said, we think we have a problem. We have the most fattening product on the planet, and everybody wants to be low fat. What do we do? We said, we want to make a low-fat donut. And we're like, hold off. Do not do that. Like, your whole brand is based on a really good donut. And if you make a low-fat donut, you're like, that's done. So I went on a journey, and they sent me down to this tiny little company in the South called Krispy Kreme. And they just opened up. Okay, I was not even old enough to rent a car. Right? I had to fax permission from my headquarters so I could rent a car. But I looked young enough that nobody saw me as threatening. And I literally videotaped people coming out of Krispy Kreme. And they were coming out with dozens, like boxes of Krispy Kreme. And I was like, why are you getting dozens of donuts? And they literally whispered into my camera, it's not for me. It's for my company. Really? It's not for me. And you could tell they were so happy to get the Krispy Kreme, like off the thing. This was before Krispy Kreme went bananas. And what we saw on their faces was just pure joy to get this little delight, this like little piece of love in this like hot off the conveyor belt Krispy Kreme. And so we did a bunch of interviews and we did a bunch of other qualitative research and we went back to Dunkin' Donuts and we're like, do not do the low-fat donut. That is not your issue. And we did this thing called a need state analysis, right, 1994. And this is the chart. I still have it. And basically we said, look, you are only focused on the marketing data, which is telling you that the only thing people are going to buy are low-fat things. But if you look at customers and you watch what they do, they actually say something different. They're stressed out. They want a cheap reward. They want to feel like childhood and apple pie. They want the smell of fresh donuts. They want to feel like life is less complicated, and they want it on the go. And half of your offering could actually deliver that. So your issue is not about the donuts. You have an opportunity to leverage the first part of your name, the Dunkin' part. So our research actually helped them understand that they really had an opportunity to expand their coffee line because it was in the Northeast where coffees were going bananas. And so we've seen, you know, I can't take full credit for their coffee strategy, but it was that moment where it's like if you look at the customers and you put on your discovery hat and you ask why are they doing that, it can be so powerful from an innovation and ideation standpoint before you're willing to test if you can actually do it or make it or if it makes money. Does the product have value? Does the idea have value? So in the book, we also talk, we have got a couple tools. We talk about the importance of observing and questioning. And we also have this customer safari, which for those of you that might have done user research, this is a way to help understand the different touch points that your customers have to understand where is their delight in their day and where is their pain and where might you understand how your offering could really help them. And so we actually give some examples of it. And all along the way in the book, we have hacks and we have useful tips of how to immediately put it in action. So what I thought I would do right now is just take a 3-minute conversation break, have you talk to your neighbor and ask yourself, like, where does discovery show up in your work? Do you talk with customers? How do you capture those insights? How do you let other people know about that discovery mode? So just take a couple minutes and talk to your neighbor and just say, where does discovery show up in my work? Or the most important thing I already learned was I got to cancel half my meetings. Your choice. Take about 3 minutes, and we'll come back and hear what you have, you know, what you came up with.
During your discovery with Dunkin' Donuts, how many cops did you talk to?
Tons. Tons of cops.
All right. So where are you doing
discovery? Okay, we're going to come back. I love the lively conversations. So can I have everyone's attention again? Does anyone want to share something about discovery in their work? Who wants to share about how discovery shows up in their work? Well, I talked to Brad, so I'm going to put you on the spot. Brad, how does discovery show up in your work?
All the time. So I own a consultancy agency, and we deal with a lot of early stage startups. And we get a lot of people coming in with very strong ideas on what needs to happen and what, you know, they think about their idea. So first couple weeks of our relationships are always a lot of discovery and helping them see what the truth is and not, you know, yeah. Which is always, isn't always what they believed it to be, yes. Coming in the door.
Yes, yes, yes. Try to pry away from those original ideas, discovery oriented. I saw another hand over there. Oh, yes. Yeah.
So I'm in a startup as well. We're pretty small, we're about 30. So we're changing the way that people are doing design thinking. And obviously, that's kind of a bold statement, right? So our clients are, wait, so you're telling me I don't do the sticky on the wall? No, that's not it. So what we learned with our discovery process isn't necessarily what we can help with them, but how we can actually transfer that to their clients.
Yeah.
Because one of our biggest clients is Accenture, so they're running consulting engagements. So how can you run a better, more engaging, more effective consulting activity with your clients on the other end? And that's what I learned from these guys, is that it's not necessarily about what you can transfer to you, but how you can take that and then better your client. Because that's what you can do.
Dare I say, you're making choices that trigger the right responses, right? You are acting like a designer. That's exactly right. And thinking about what are the multiple impacts of those choices in order to ultimately get others to be successful. Thank you for sharing that. That's great. Terrific. All right. Well, I'm going to move on to our second one. I hope you keep thinking about this. This is great. I'm glad that you already learned something from your conversations. There's a lot when we just pause and ask each other these questions. Can we be discovery driven with ourselves, right? I mean, one of the things I'm working on is noticing more and wondering, huh, I wonder why that happened or why I had that reaction. That's also very useful, particularly when we're dealing with high situations of uncertainty, knowing how we react in there. So it can be useful on ourselves as well. So the second big principle I want to throw out there is this notion around modeling generative collaboration. So I was very careful when I chose these words, modeling generative collaboration. And why this is so critical in the design process. Yesterday I was doing an interview and somebody said, you know, you said in your book, no like solo acts. And I said, yes, it's true, because we need a diverse group of people around us to help us develop ideas, to help them test quickly, to help bring them out into the world, to make sure that we are getting the best feedback that we can from many different kinds of perspectives, and that we need diverse kinds of talent to quickly bring those ideas forward. We don't just need a bunch of people that are really good in one single kind of skill set or come from one function. And I want to suggest that collaboration's been a topic for a long time. It was just on the cover story of the Harvard Business Review not too long ago. And when I talk to executives about collaboration, and then I talk to people that work for those executives, what I've come to learn is that collaboration is usually a code word for politics. It's sort of like, yeah, we need to create a cross-functional team, and we'll just get all these people together, and you know, and it looks something like this, right? I've invited you today not because the topic is relevant, but because I didn't want you to feel left out. And you know, notice these people Skyping in from London and New York and Tokyo. So it's like 3 a.m, and they're like, I don't even know why I'm here, but I'm here because I'm on this cross-functional team. And we tend to think of these teams kind of like Noah's Ark, like let's get like 2 from compliance and 2 from product and 2 from marketing and 2 from sales, and then where's our team, right? We don't really put a lot of design intentionality to who we need on the team. Like, hey, are we all from the same region? Are we all from the same generation? Are we all coming from the same department? And what we're learning about human nature is that we are political in our DNA. And Franz De Waal has done some amazing work with chimpanzees to suggest that it's not just humans that are political. Even chimpanzees are political. And I encourage you to watch his TED Talk about chimpanzees realizing, like, when one of them gets a piece of cheese and the other gets a cucumber, the chimpanzee with the cucumber starts chucking it back, you know, at the trainer, right? And you realize, like, we have this innate sense of fairness, and that's actually served us really well to survive in the early times. And you as a designer can make choices to either trigger bad politics, where we're kind of like protecting our turf and we're protecting our budget and we're protecting our talent, or good politics, where we're looking for ways to collaborate and learn from each other. Because what we're now learning about situations that are highly uncertain, that are filled with a lot of variability, that question our connection with each other, it actually triggers similar parts in our brain as where we feel physical pain. So right, think about this. At the precise moment, you're like, look, we got to bring a new product to market. There's no evidence to suggest that this product's going to do well. And by the way, you don't have as much money as you need, and you're going to be assigned to work with these people that you don't know very well. Go be creative and solve it. Right? You're like, are you kidding? What? No, no. Right? Your brain is going like, no, I'm done. So you as a designer, if you're in charge of actually bringing those people together, you've got to design conditions for people to be generative. And I think to your point earlier about design thinking, when it first came out in the Post-it notes, for example, they were so liberating as a medium to present ideas. I think we've sort of over-indexed on Post-it notes, so now we're getting that, no more Post-it notes. But at the time, it was sort of like, how do we make our ideas more democratic? That was, I think, one of the best uses of Post-it notes. So we need to, as designers, move away from politics to be more modelers and really enactors of generative collaboration. And I think there's really no better example of this than Saturday Night Live. Any Saturday Night Live fans here? Yeah, look at that. Yes. And it was amazing at the Emmys. Like, they're still getting nominated for lots of awards 40 years later. Like, why? Why does Saturday Night Live work? And in part, it works because Lorne Michaels was genius, the producer and founder, executive producer, of creating many different kinds of talent and figuring out what does the scene need based on the talent that we have. And all members of the ensemble are deeply practiced in improv, improvisation. This notion of being able to create something based on offers being given to you by your partner. It's not a show of stand-up. Really, the only kind of monologue is the one of the guest star in front that's deeply scripted, and it's usually better when there's some interplay with the ensemble. So what they're doing is they're giving and receiving offers to each other in a very generative, co-creative way. And so I've spent a lot of time studying the practices of improv. And just one book for you to think about is this wonderful book by Second City in Chicago called Yes And, which talks about how you can create some of those incentives, some of those mechanisms for being a generative collaborator into your organization. And I'll just share a quote here from one of my absolute favorite generative collaborators, Stephen Colbert, who says, "You are not the most important person in the scene." And if you watch him when he interviews people, he's not trying to one-up his guest. He's trying to help them feel comfortable so that the audience is really the hero of the moment, right? The people watching. And so that's really an act of brilliance to watch. Jimmy Fallon's the same. I mean, he has a more playful way. But if you watch great facilitators, they are enabling the people in the room to be successful. And they're doing that in a way that allows different kinds of talent to recombine so that something new emerges. It's really an incredible thing to watch. And so one of the things that we offer in the book is this notion of how do you get your team to really bond from the beginning, before you're in the thick of the nastiness and the failures happen and you're freaking out. And so we really talk about the importance of a team charter, to spend time when you're with the team saying, what do we care about? How do we work well together? How are we going to deal with conflict? Before, what are our learning goals? What are developmental goals? And so this is just an example of the team charter. For the last 6 years when I've been teaching innovation, it's the first day of their graduate program. I put them in teams because I know it's too much of an ask to actually have them like, oh, well, I'm sitting next to each other. Do you want to be deeply connected for the next 100 hours? I just don't think that's fair. So I assign teams based on their backgrounds. But I said the very, very first assignment that you have to do is to create a team charter. Get to know each other. Go have a beer. Go learn what you care about. And that's their first assignment. And so last year, we studied the future of voting, of all things. And they would present charters that look like this, where they talked about their innovator's DNA, where they talked about their incoming strengths. Were they good at observing? Were they good at questioning? Were they good at experimenting? And what do they want to work on? They talked about their standards. What does high quality look like? Because these are strangers that need to now really work closely together. They talked about their roles and what success looked like. And this team chose to visualize it this way. Another team chose to visualize it this way. This is an example. Again, they took the political theme seriously. Ironically, this was a team of all international students. I thought that was hilarious. Where they talked about, wow, we really care about these values. We want to contribute and help and encourage. And this is how it's going to show up. This is how we are going to behave with each other. We are going to listen, and we are going to plan, and we are going to forgive. And these things really matter when you are in the heat of battle. The fact that you've taken time to make sure that you've really tried to understand how you can help each other be successful, how you can set the other person up for success. And in the book, we talk about the importance of learning skills that, again, we don't talk about but are critical, skills of facilitation. Do you actually know how to facilitate? Have you spent time practicing facilitating? Do you know what a good facilitator even looks like? What are their tools in their trip? You're not born facilitators. It's a learned skill. And how to manage energy is critical. Critical when you're starting, critical when you're in the heat of it, critical when you're trying to prepare to share it. Learning how to manage energy from the team to harness their best talent. We learn differently. We get excited by different things. How do you figure out how to make choices to get that to work together? Figuring out how to work visually. And throughout the book, we have many different visual tools to help you have these conversations and facilitate them well, with hacks and with suggestions on how to do it. So really knowing what your tools are, what the space is like, and how you're going to get people to work collaboratively. So I'm going to ask that you think about this because I want to get to Q&A. So Dan told me you're talking a bunch, so I want to make sure we get out here on time. But ask yourself, how do you facilitate generative collaboration? Do I know enough? Do I need to take a facilitation course? What are conversations that I've been in that have gone really well? What did the facilitator do? How can I learn from that? This is a critical skill for design, and it's one of the ones I'm most excited that others are going to get a chance to learn because of the book. So I encourage you to think about that. All right, the last part I want to talk about, and then we're going to open up for some questions, is this notion about scaling design, right? Can we scale design? What is our responsibility of leaders to actually scale design? And again, I want to suggest that we can think of design as, in some ways, a synonym for innovation. And we're still talking about innovation. We got to be innovative, right? And so I thought this was a hilarious cartoon that sort of talks about all the different ways we talk about innovation, right? It's incremental, line extension, copycat, watered down, breakthrough. That will never work, right? And every day, some executive is waking up after reading some article that talked about innovation, and they go to their company and they're going, "We've got to be more innovative," right? Have you heard this? Anybody here have a mandate that says we've got to be more innovative? Or you heard that at the offsite, right? We've got to be. So you go and you take this. I've got to be more innovative. I got to be better. I got to come up with great ideas. So you have a great weekend. You got the mandate from the top. I'm going to be innovative. And you go in to work on Monday and you say, "Oh my gosh, I've got this great idea. I've got this really great idea. It's fantastic." And your colleague listens to you patiently, and then they say, "Yeah, well, that sounds amazing. That sounds great. Yeah." But you know what they're really thinking? They're thinking, "Yeah, but that would never happen here." I'm telling you, that's what they're thinking. Like, "Yeah, but no," right? And this is one of, we can look at the statistics about why so many innovation initiatives fail. It's not for funding. Tons of research going into and spending on innovation. It's because we haven't figured out how to scale a yes and mentality. We haven't figured out how to invest in the skills that will allow these ideas to see another day with data, right? Because I got to tell you, yeah buts are everywhere. "Yeah, but we don't have the people. Yeah, but we don't have the budget. Yeah, but we don't have the time. Yeah, but we have different incentives. Yeah, but we got to meet our quarterly numbers. Yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but, yeah, but." And the worst ones are the ones that they don't actually say out loud, "Yeah, but." They're still nodding, right? You've gotten that one. "Yeah, it's a great idea. Yeah, but." They're thinking, "Yeah, but," right? So I would like to suggest, and this is my most passionate work that I'm deeply excited about, we need more designers of better businesses. That is where all of us comes in. We all need to think of ourselves as designers of better businesses, right? We need to go move from this capability gaps to really say, the reason why innovation is not working because we've never really been taught how to do it. We haven't taught the skills. We don't really have a process. We need practice time. We need to learn from each other. We need scalable learning to a learnable discipline. This is the hope for design, to turn it into a learnable discipline that we can all benefit from. And that is the essence of this book, to understand that uncertainty actually may be our most secret weapon. That this could be, if we're comfortable with these skills because we've practiced, an unbelievable opportunity for us to stay relevant, to actually continue to create products that serve the real needs of our customers, and to do it in a way that's truly profitable, that can lead us to sustainable growth. And so that is where this process comes in, a scalable process that we can all learn, that's backed by skills that we can all learn. So we talk about 7 design skills in the book that are critical. We talked about some of them tonight, starting with the customer, working visually, not flying solo, telling stories. These are all skills that we can practice and learn, and having a scalable toolkit. So in the book, we have 20 different visual tools that are all going to be available by Creative Commons that you can play with. You don't need all of them, but you need to know you're not alone. You don't have to look at this blank flip chart and be like, "Uh-oh. They told me to be innovative. Now what?" Right? There's places to go. There's tools to help you. There's people that are trying this out. And then you can hack them your own way. And because we were so focused on making the book designed for your behalf, we know you don't read. We created a scalable start. There's a fast pass in the beginning. So you can figure out what you need and go right to that page. Right? This is what it means to be a designer, to make choices that trigger the right responses. Because you know what? Ideas are easy, but driving impact is hard. And I think that is the real work that we have to do as designers. And I want to end with a final story. We talk a little bit about the book. A dear friend of mine, incredibly talented colleague by the name of Corey Ford, who started a really exciting accelerator in the city called Matter. Matter's focused on changing public media for good. And what I love about Corey, he started about 4 years ago. He was a designer. He spent time at the Stanford D School. He was actually originally a documentarian, for Frontline. So he was steeped deeply in personas, right, in understanding what it takes to tell a good story. And then he went to business school and married those two together. And he said, you know, we need to create a special kind of process, a scalable process, 20 weeks, for new media entrepreneurs to come and experience the design process, not just as a single-day boot camp, but as the way that they grow their business. And so everything is oriented around these design reviews. They have these four-week sprints and a design review, four-week sprints and a design review. And the thing that Corey did that was so spectacular to support these design sprints is that he partnered with existing media organizations like KQED and more recently the New York Times, because he doesn't just want the entrepreneurs in his accelerator to be successful. He actually wants to ignite change within these large, more traditional media companies. And I'm just so inspired. He's constantly iterating. He's constantly trying to change his model. And his point is that, yes, we want a financial return, but even more, we want an organizational return. That is really what we're focused on. And so I just, and he's documenting everything. So I picked this up on Medium. And this was an article about KQED and the transformation that they're happening. So for those of you that don't know, that's our local public radio station. And I love this quote by the CEO. He said, you know, outside in is one of the reasons why we invested in Matter. We're not actually looking for a financial return as much as an innovation return. So they're really betting down on the capabilities that they're going to learn by partnering with Matter. And he goes on to say, Clayton Christensen emphasizes the culture of forces. Matter is one way that KQED can not only step up the environment for disruptive innovation, but also remain close to it. So notice the sense that we're going to learn together, right? We're going to stay connected to the entrepreneurs, and we're going to support them, and they're going to support us. So they're modeling discovery, they're modeling generative collaboration, and they're doing it in a way that scales design capacity within their organization. And I think this is the future of learning. So we're always looking for the models, like how do we actually bring innovation into our organization? You bring it by finding a shared learning agenda and a reason for you to actually work together, not just be sequestered in the training room, but actually work together and have the time to say, what did we learn? And how could we do it better the next time? So one of the things that Matter is doing along the way is that they are telling stories that matter. And that is the final tool and skill that I'm going to leave you with tonight, which is the importance of storytelling, the importance of learning what the story is of your team, the story is of your product, the story is of your customer that you're trying to learn, and to keep practicing telling that story. Because ultimately, it's the stories that are going to engage us in that emotional side of the equation that we started this talk talking about. It's not the utility. You all are building great features. It's the engagement that is really going to allow you to have that scalable growth. And I have to tell you from my own experience, when you're trying to bring design into an organization, half the time you need to do it like through a Trojan horse, right? Like don't lead, like I'm a designer, you're a designer, let's go design. No, you got to find ways, you got to find the currencies that matter to them, and you have to deliver on that to get the opportunity to scale this within the organization. Because ultimately, I want to suggest as leaders, as designers, what responses do we want to trigger? Right? Do we want to be in that rap rage where you're frustrated with yet another meeting, yet another product that's not gone right, yet another experience of working with someone that's frustrating? Or do you want to trigger a response where you're there literally holding on to the agenda that you created, right? The stuff that's no longer relevant because it was so meaningful to them. And I will say, just like that Dunkin' Donuts meeting, I have kept the artifacts of meaningful moments for years because they remind me of the value that I brought to that project and what we created together. So you have the power to design that within the choices you make every day. I want to suggest that designing better businesses starts with you. And so with that, I just want to thank you. It's been a true pleasure to be here.
Well, thank you very much, Lisa, for an awesome talk. So we'll do Q&A. As you guys know, if you haven't been here before, we have one mic on each side of the room. Just raise your hand and someone will give it to you. You may have to wait for the previous person to finish before you can ask your question, okay? So who's got the first question here for Lisa? All right.
Hi, Lisa. Thanks. That was awesome. What are three characteristics that you see within successful facilitators?
Ah, that's great. Great question. Number one, they're amazing listeners. Great facilitators are unbelievable listeners, and they're not just listening for words, they're listening for energy. Like they're watching the energy in the room, they're noticing flags, they're sort of feeling where things are. So they're great listeners. Another thing is that they're unbelievable preparers. And that's a lot about my first book, Designing Better Conversations. That book's not about facilitation, but it's about all the prep work that happens ahead of time. I think we tend to think of facilitators as the person like, who wants to facilitate today? Okay, you, will you be at the flip chart with the marker and just take some notes? That's not what I'm talking about. If you're really facilitating a conversation, you're thinking deeply about the time that you're going to be together, about who is in the room, about what you want to accomplish and why. And then the last thing I would say is it's sort of connected really with both those two parts, they understand where they're going to go next. So facilitators, like one of the reasons why I think we're getting Post-it backlash is that Post-it notes signify that we all have good ideas and that they can be on this Post-it and then on the wall, but then what happens? Nothing. They stay on the wall. So it's actually worse than if we never had that brainstorming meeting to begin with because we feel like we've given a piece of our creativity and it stayed there on that wall that went nowhere. So listening, preparing, and then knowing what you're going to do after. So thanks. We want to get to the seconds of Buca di Beppo.
You can get up and get that.
Yeah, right.
Thank you for great information and advice. So I'm just curious, in the big company, like how do you bring or get the support from the executives? Like sometimes they're stubborn and it's hard to negotiate or persuade them.
That is such a great question. We talk a little bit about this in the book, too, in the prepare section. I think you've got to find ambassadors. You've got to get top-down support. If you don't have at least some air cover from the top, it's like a kamikaze mission. I mean, it's really tough to do, particularly if you don't think that you can get buy-in, right? Sometimes you need to architect these small wins so that they see. I mean, so I would say, so first of all, it's critical. So it's a fantastic question. The other thing I would say is that most executives might seem unfriendly to these ideas, not because they don't like the ideas, but it's new. It's new to them. And so it feels threatening because it's not how they've been brought up or it's not what they know. So if you can find ways, that's that like Trojan horse model. If you can find ways to even start the conversation about why working differently might be beneficial, and I have all kinds of strategies. It's from, hey, why don't we go and visit, you know, Airbnb? Let's just go to the atrium and just see this beautiful building. Wow, I wonder how they did, you know, and just get them to go and get them to, and now you're like, wow, you know what, the Airbnb, they did some really interesting choices about their business model. Can I tell you? And you kind of engage in conversation, or you can watch a movie together. I mean, there's all different entry points. But the thing is, as a designer, you have to be empathetic to the currencies that matter to the executives. And you figure out, like, what matters to them, and then you start to speak the language, or you start to seed stories that help them feel like what you're going to want to work on is going to get them what they want. Over time, when people kind of, you know, bristle away at the newness and they get bought in, they will become your best advocate. So that's what. The other thing is you got to feed them stories. So I'll give you just another quick example. I worked with an executive team of a global financial services bank, and all the executives were on the East Coast. They didn't really get the Silicon Valley thing. They probably learned most of it from, like, watching Silicon Valley on HBO, right? They're like, what are you guys doing? You guys are building robots all the time. Like, what? You don't know about financial services. It happens here in New York. And so they want, as a way of opening up the conversation, they created a two-day learning journey to San Francisco. And I said, you know, there really needs to be a conversation. It can't be like just a look and see, and here's Apple and Google, and okay, let's get back on the plane. You know, really need to sort of unpack. You need to get up close and personal. I said, but the most important thing you need to do, harking back to this conversation, is you got to enable them to tell the story of what they saw and felt while they were here. So they brought in two visual designers who throughout the conversation just sat in the back. They took notes. They took sketch notes. They did pictures. And this the tour started Sunday, and they were back on the plane on Tuesday. By Friday, in their inbox, they had a 25-page visual PDF in their email. And the number one success criteria was how often are those executives going to hit forward on the email? Oh, my gosh, I did this amazing thing. Forward, 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 right? So they made them look like a hero, and they created the lessons in a way that they could share more widely. Now you're creating a movement. So the detailed answer. But yes, thanks.
Yeah. When you talked about scaling design, you talked about bringing teams together and getting them to be more creative. One of the, and you also spoke about a term I'll use, the empire builders and the zero-sum gamers.
Yes.
who they don't want to chime in because they think they're going to lose.
Right.
How do you get them into a more win-win mentality and we're all moving forward in the same direction mentality?
Yeah, hard work. I mean, that's what it's like. Ideas are easy. Impact is hard. That's the hard work. And part of it is understanding what they care about to let them loosen up a little bit. And that's not going to happen often with like the direct, you know, I might have to do some of the discovery work around, you know, what sometimes people really care about egos, right? Like, oh, I've got this great idea. It's going to make you look awesome, you know, and you just feed into a little bit. You're just trying to figure out how to get them on your side and, you know, again, get some of that like I win, you lose mentality off and how we do it. So there's lots of different strategies. It can be tricky. And I guess one of the biggest questions you need to learn along the way is like, is this a showstopper? Is this a constraint I can't get behind? Is you know, if what I need to be successful ultimately needs to go through this naysayer, right? Like at what point is this just too big to tackle? And you may not know that from the beginning. So that's one thought. The other thought is I cannot overstate the importance of framing. And I go into this in more detail in my first book. When we talk about innovation, and it's connected to that first point I made, we typically think about ideation. Actually, the first step is understanding, building understanding. Why are we even innovating in the first place? Is it because our business model's not working? Is it because we're not relevant with our customers? Is it because we're not disciplined in how we deliver it? So if you can do discovery work on why it's necessary, and then you have real data that's not like, well, this is my subjective point of view, but let me tell you the data. And we've got a great case study about Toyota Financial Services, actually in both books, where they wanted an innovation session, but the most important thing that came out of it was they didn't know who their customers were. Half the company thought the customers were dealers, the other half thought they were drivers, and a whole other half thought it's the headquarters in Japan. Well, how are they possibly going to align on a new idea if they can't even figure out who it is they're trying to serve? So building understanding, I think, is your key.
More comment than question, but you talked about storytelling, and I found some of the most important storytelling is get those actual richly detailed stories of customer needs, pains, experiences, whatever with the product, and make sure you're ready to tell those whenever you have to talk to the executives, because if you don't have a compelling story, you can show all the data you want.
I couldn't agree more, right? Get those quotes, get their pictures, get their buy-in. Let me talk about Mary. Yes, I couldn't agree more.
Another question.
Me again. Hi, Lisa. What are, in your opinion, what are two critical events that need to take place within an organization to bring design and that type of thinking beyond just the title of designer?
Yeah. Great question. I'm going to keep thinking about that. Two critical things that need to happen?
Or just one?
For it to really scale, I do think you need executive buy-in. You can create a movement, you know, and then at some point somebody needs to be the connective tissue. I talk about the importance of strategic toggling. You need a strategic toggler. You'd be like, you know, all this school activity, let me tell you why this really matters to our bottom line. You know, all these stories we're gathering, let me tell you about why this really helps us understand our customers. So I think you really need to get clarity about the why behind all this activity in a way that the executive team or at least key ambassadors understand.
So in your book, I was wondering if you talk about speed and execution of an idea and kind of like a time frame, if an idea does have a time frame.
Yeah, it's a great, we don't explicitly say you need these weeks and, you know, we don't break it down quite to that specificity. But I think certainly in the prototyping and validating sections, you know, we really talk about the importance of testing your riskiest assumption first. And, you know, again, that's a critical thinking skill. Like, do we even know what our riskiest assumption is? Do we even know how to articulate an assumption? Is this something that we just think of as a given? So it takes time to really, you know, like painstakingly say, well, if this idea is to be successful, what are all the things that need to go right? What's the most important thing we test for the cheapest amount of money? So obviously in Lean Startup, there's a lot of talk about MVPs, but I would say in a more broader context, it could be organizational alignment. You know, so this is a great idea, but would this fly because it might cannibalize this other profitable idea? If that's the assumption you need to test, then those are the conversations that you need to have. So it's not quite the speed, but really this discipline around what's the most important thing for us to gather evidence on so that we understand if we can even take this the next day.
Hello. Can you speak a little bit more about the group in the collaborative process, and do you feel it's more about skill sets, or is it more about psychological abilities and, you know, people being willing to take, what would you say is like your optimum group to be collaborative?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm not sure I know the magic eight ball answer of, you know, the exact people, but I appreciate that you brought up both aspects. I think that in any group that's trying to bring something new, you want to get some diversity of skills. You want to get someone that can give form to the ideas quickly, and I don't mean data, right? You definitely need some people that can crunch numbers and say what's the market opportunity and what's the potential profitability and what are comparables and those kinds of things. But I really think it's critical to have a UX person or a graphic designer on your team that can very quickly say, oh, that story, does it look like this? Sketch it out. The moment you have a sketch of an idea is the moment you can start getting feedback on it. So I highly, highly advocate getting some kind of visual practitioner on your team early so that you can very quickly start to show it to people to just get reactions. You probably also need some technical support to help understand, you know, well, what would it take to build that? So, you know, those are some of the skills. I couldn't agree more that temperament is huge. And what I mean by that is that you need people that are hustlers. You need people that are comfortable with ambiguity. You need people that don't lead with status, you know, but really recognize that ideas can come from everywhere. Now, I want to be clear. I don't also mean that everybody needs to be a Pollyanna. Like, you don't need to only recruit cheerleaders. Like, it's a great idea. I think that some of the people that have pragmatic optimism and are willing to voice their concerns in a productive way are some of the most important people to have on your team. They are hard to find. They're really hard to find. I mean, there's a great chapter in a book that I loved by Ed Catmull called Creativity, Inc. And in that book, he is the founder and CEO of Pixar, and he talks about that the secret sauce to them having 15 blockbuster successes, you know, busting creative boundaries everywhere, kind of like what Corey does in his design review. They have this thing called a brain trust, where the director will call many different kinds of people at certain points in the movie to get honest feedback. Now, their job is not to solve it. Their job is not to, you know, join the team. Their job is to give as many pieces of feedback as possible wherever that director is at that moment of time so that the director has more choices and outside-in voices. It's not about being mean. It's not about being judgmental. It's just about getting the data up there. And it's a skill that we practice at the Design MBA. Can you give critique productively? And can you hear critique productively? So, great question. Yes.
Yeah, I'm wondering if you talk a little bit about organizational modeling and specifically around designing a better business where you're entering into a model that exists and, for lack of a better way of saying it, putting this around it or putting it into it. How do you go about really making that change, whether you have executive sponsorship or not?
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, I definitely do not have the secret sauce there. And, you know, there's a lot of philosophies around kind of putting it at the edge so you're not distracted by the main and then slowly seeing if some of the new ideas might, you know, infiltrate. I think the key is, whatever the model is, you know, the key is to learn, right? The key is to not just talk about the successes, but to talk about the how as much as possible so that you're building the capabilities of people along the way. So I know there are a lot of different models. I really don't have an opinion. There's another great case in HBR came out a couple of years ago about Intuit and how they scaled innovation. And they really built this very robust catalyst program. It took a huge investment. Not all companies can do that, right? Other people have done it. I know similar models like creating scrum masters, right? You know, all this notion of like, how do we get people more comfortable with some of the skills that we'll need to ultimately get the whole organization working this way? But in the meanwhile, you know, what are the choices we're going to take to architect some wins so that people are at least intrigued? Like, wow, you ship that product that actually is making money in a month? How'd you do that? To document the process as much as the end result. But I'm going to keep investigating for you, because I think it's an important question. Yeah.
So you mentioned meeting rage, which is a pet peeve of, I'm sure, everyone here. it may not be exactly what I think you came here to talk about, but I'd love to hear if you had any ideas about antidotes to it.
Yeah.
To the overscheduling.
Overscheduling. I mean, it's, you know, first of all, it's pausing, right, to even look at our calendar. How many people show up, like, get up in the morning, you're like, so what's happening today? What's on my calendar, right? Like, could you pause even on Sunday and say, what are the range of places that I will be in meetings, you know, the range of meetings I'll be in this week? And then say, like, is my participation critical here? Like, do I even know why I'm invited, you know, and what's expected of me. And if the answer is no, I might consider dropping the meeting organizer a note to say, hey, I saw that you asked for an hour and a half of my time on Wednesday. Can you give me more of a, you know, window into how I can be helpful to you? And if they say, well, I just want you there because I want you to hear it, you're like, great, can somebody else take notes? And I'd love to hear about it after, right? Like, here's the thing about meetings is that we allow our time to be given to somebody else without really asking for what the exchange is in return, right? If somebody went into your wallet and was like, hey, I'm going to just take this $50, it's cool, right? It's cool. You'd be like, wait, what? For what? What are you taking? You would never accept that. And the ironic thing about that is that you can get $50 back, but you cannot get that time back. So we need to get a lot more serious about our standards. Ideally, it becomes a cultural standard, and that's another part about scaling design is that, you know, we make things more democratic and collaborative in the time that we give back by being sequestered in these meetings. So I think it's really just starting with intentionality. And again, when you starting with yourself, when you organize a meeting, send out expectations ahead of time. And I'm not talking about 5 minutes ahead of time. I'm talking about a couple days. Like, get known as the person that is always going to deliver value back to you for the time that you gave back to them. And that might give you a leg to be like, look, you don't get my time unless you design it better.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So if you don't mind, I'm just going to ask a question on the microphone here.
Yeah.
So I work with a lot of sales folks, and as we all know, this process to do it right takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
Any tips for how to accelerate these insights through this cycle?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, well, first of all, salespeople can be like your biggest yeah butters on the planet. Like, to be clear, like, yeah, but no, you can't come with me on my side. You know, like, they're terrified of you. Like, discovery mode is like poison to salespeople. Like, no, I am in delivery mode, right? I am in closing mode. You are not opening up open-ended questions, right? So first of all, you have to kind of generate trust there. And you definitely obviously don't want to go behind their back. I mean, you want to be like, hey, wow, you're doing visits? Can I come? I just want to come. I'm great. I'll carry your bag. I won't say a word. I'm just going to listen. Just make up a name for me, right? So you got to, like, you know, get their trust. And then maybe after debrief, you know, and I think it's also having that empathetic mind where it's like, you're listening to what their customers are saying, but you're also listening to the salespeople. Like, what do they need to make their jobs more successful? You might learn just as much about that. Like, oh, wow, they didn't really know how to talk about the product, or they didn't really ask the right questions to the customer. And so you might be able to coach them with your empathetic mind that they might be able to get double, you know. And a lot of also connections that can happen between salespeople and between salespeople and other parts of the organization is another sort of attribute that I take very seriously about being a network weaver. You know, like, hey, did you know that this thing is coming? Like, if you're in designer, chances are you're touching lots of different departments. And so you have this currency called knowledge, right, and relationships. And how can you be generous with that so that salespeople feel like that they've got more people behind their, you know, like, helping them as opposed to just being the lone closer. So, but they can be your best advocates or your best enemies. So it's important.
Let's do one last question. Okay.
Yep.
A lot of what you talked about, it makes obvious sense if you're in a product business and you're trying to figure out your next generation product, or if your business is cratering, disaster, changes something, and you need to fix something quickly. What about a company that might be doing pretty well and kind of has a process for getting products out, but there are some things just organizationally you need to change, right? The management team has its patterns, its behaviors, and you aren't just operating as efficiently as you need to be. So how do you use what you have in this book to address the problem of organizational change, management attitude, culture building change, not just a culture around the design process,
yeah,
but
for sure,
the rest of the culture in a company?
I mean, culture is tricky, right? I mean, as Peter Drucker said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. Boy, is that true. You know, and I would say from a designer's perspective, again, what are the choices that we're making that trigger the right responses? So if we want to trigger different responses organizationally, we need to pay attention to the small choices we're making that either make the culture one way or another. So for example, you could decide to say, you know, that all hands meeting that we typically have and we just celebrate the people that have totally kicked butt. Let's do something different. Let's have an all-hands meeting where we celebrate the best questions asked or you know, the best learning or the best opportunity that we weren't expecting that saved you know, the company a lot of money. Because I, you know, I think part of your premise is like, what happens when things are going well enough that there's no urgency to change? And in some ways, you've got to create enough fire so that they do change. And you could either do it, you know, the old with vitamins or aspirin. And look, it's hard to change people with vitamins. It just is. So, you know, then you kind of figure out, well, if we don't have a headache, can I like make us feel a headache? Or, you know, and so one way you might want to do that is actually to do like a tour of the future. So like we're sitting pretty now, but I just want to do a tour of the future about all the things that are coming down the pike that actually might disrupt us. So I've invited these futurists in, or I've invited these technologists in, and they're going to talk about like, what is the future of autonomous cars? And how might that totally disrupt our business in 5 years that we're not thinking about today? So that's a way of igniting some heat. You could decide to go the other way and say, like, you know what, we're going to do something fun. And one of my, I said earlier, I am deeply passionate about improv right now. I love bringing improv into organizational meetings because I think it is one of the most kinesthetic and deeply moving learning experiences when it's done right. Right? Again, coming back to framing, not like, hey, we're all going to be more generative, like, woohoo, yes, and, but more like, we need to learn to be more resilient in the face of disruption and change. So we are going to start to practice what it feels like to be out of our comfort zone. Right? That's a much different framing of going into an experience than we need to be more creative, so let's be creative. So paying attention to how you frame learning opportunities and how you're doing it in a way that really gets people attention, you know, just a thought. And then last thing I'll say, if it's not obvious already, like use outside sources, you know, to your favor. Start a book club. Hey, wow, I just read this book, Design a Better Business. No, I read another book, you know. I read Creativity Inc. Wow, the way Pixar works. Let's all read it. Or here's the Fast Company article about the brain trust. Let's all circulate it. Can we have a brain trust here? What would it look like to have a brain trust? So use analogs to help bring in some small movements. And then once that works, then you build on that. Great.
Guys, thanks again, Lisa. Yeah, thank you so much.